playing.
Good evening. Sorry, I was back there talking and wasn't watching the clock. We're going to begin with blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day.
Good evening, everyone. Feel like we're leaning that way. It's good to see everyone. We welcome you back to our evening service. We appreciate those watching us on Facebook or YouTube. A few quick announcements before we turn it back over to Brother Eugene. I want to remind everyone of our midweek activities. Tuesday, Gillsburg Grub, 11 to 12 on Tuesday. Wednesday is our midweek prayer service, 5:30 is supper. 6 o'clock, we break into our groups. And then Thursday is the Claiborne Sunday School at 2 o'clock at the Claiborne. Also, want to continue to remind you about our Margaret Lackey State offering. Ask that you pray about that, and if you feel led to give to that, please do so. Remember, next Sunday evening, we will be dismissed for the concert at New Heights Baptist Church for all those who want to go to that. And then also, something you need to add to your calendar. So the 15th, next Sunday evening, we will be dismissed for the New Heights concert there. And then the 22nd, 2 weeks from tonight, we're going to have what we're calling a dream night in the Fellowship Hall. So 2 weeks from tonight, the 22nd, is kind of what we're calling a dream night in the Fellowship Hall at 6 o'clock. The idea behind this is the Long Range Planning Committee has been working. You know of the surveys that have gone out the last few weeks. And we're going to kind of get together on that Sunday night, the 22nd, in the Fellowship Hall, and as church-wide, for everyone to come, and kind of talk about our plans for the church, our dreams. Where do we want to be in a year? Where do we want to be in 3 years? Where do we want to be in 5 years? And open it up to everyone and then just have a good conversation back there of kind of where we want to head, get us pointed in the right direction, have a focus. And so that will be the 22nd. So next Sunday night, concert at New Heights Baptist Church. The 22nd will be Dream Night at 6 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. And then the 29th will be our fifth Sunday singing right here on the 29th. So just wanted to get everybody up to date on our Sunday evening schedule going forward. Concert next Sunday, the 22nd, Dream Night in the Fellowship Hall. Then we'll be back in here on the 29th for fifth Sunday singing. Any other announcements that I need to make tonight? If not, it's good to see everybody. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll continue with Brother Eugene. Father, again, we thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to gather together tonight and worship you, Lord. We just pray that everything we do tonight, Lord, singing, praying, meditating on your word, we will do in a way that brings glory and honor to you. We just are grateful for the fact that you are our creator, and that's why we worship you, Lord, because you created us. And we just pray, Lord, that we will prepare our hearts and minds for you to speak to us tonight, Lord, that we will remove the distractions of the world, the things that we've been doing this evening, the things that we've got to do tonight and tomorrow, remove that from our hearts and minds and allow us to sit here and really focus on you tonight, Lord. We just pray safety over us tonight as we worship here in the sanctuary. Just ask that you keep us safe as we depart here. We just pray, Lord, that you'll forgive us where we fail you, and we just ask for your wisdom, your knowledge, and your guidance, Lord, to make the decisions that you'd have us make to get this church going along the path and continue along the path that you'd have us be on, Lord. We thank you again, and we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Okay, our next hymn will be What a Friend We Have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Oh, because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Despise, forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee, thou wilt find a solace there.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in a foreign land. When the crowd knelt to the idol, they boldly took their stand. Not afraid of the evil king or the fiery furnace flames. Where others would have buckled, their faith in God remained.
And they stood true.
They stood true when there was nothing left to do.
This man standing still in faithfulness, he faced the lion's den. When all he had was Jesus, old Daniel would not bend.
And they stood true.
They stood true when there was nothing left to do.
They held their ground.
They held their ground when no earthly help was found. God and they stood true.
Jesus has. He boldly preached the word. All the scoffing Pharisees despise the truth they heard. They stoned the fearless preacher as he lifted up his eyes. Then Jesus stood to welcome him at the Father's side. And they stood true.
They stood true when there was nothing left to do.
All right, you can go ahead and clap that group. I picked that song for a reason. I like that group. They're kind of a young and up-and-coming group, and I think they have a real chance. But they talked about some things that I think perhaps go with our message tonight, and I want to share with you from God's Word. And you notice they talked about Daniel and Stephen and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those characters that all of us have known about for so long, they stood true when there was nothing left to do, nothing else to do. They looked around when no earthly help was found. I think those words ring true for all of us. So I want to talk to you tonight for a few minutes from the Old Testament about no other God, no other God. And we'll look at two passages of Scripture there. There'll be no stranger to you, but a couple of things in there that I hope we'll see tonight that may be something new that you'll stir your thinking and redeem your understanding for a few minutes. First passage is Deuteronomy chapter 6. So turn with me to the old book of Deuteronomy there and look at chapter 6. We're going to read the first 9 verses together. And then we'll turn to Exodus for a passage that will be no stranger. Deuteronomy chapter 6, these are the commands, decrees, and regulations that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you. You must obey them in the land that you are about to enter and occupy, and you and your children and grandchildren must fear the Lord your God as long as you live. If you obey all his decrees and commands, you will enjoy a long life. Listen closely, Israel, and be careful to obey. Then all will go well with you, and you will have many children in the land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. And then this very significant passage. Listen, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road, when you're going to bed, when you're getting up. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your forehead as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. And then in Exodus chapter 20, which you know is the reading of the law here. Exodus chapter 20, then God gave the people all these instructions. I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of slavery. You must not have any other God but me. Now, many times we stop right there. And I want you to see the significance of verse 4 through 6, because they are there for a purpose. Verse 3 is certainly important, and it gives to us the basic thought for our message tonight. But verse 4 says, you must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or an image of anything in the heavens or in the earth or in the sea. Look at the scope of that. You must not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God who will not tolerate your affection for any other gods. I lay the sins of the parents upon their children, and the entire family is affected, even children in the third and fourth generations of those who reject me. Do you see the importance of these passages? But I lavish unfailing love for 1,000 generations on those who love me and obey my commands. You know that monotheism is a belief in one God. That's a compound word, mono meaning one, and theism meaning God. The Hebrew people were passionate about this concept. In fact, most scholars equate their passionate thought about this to reject other gods, and they say that ethical monotheism, if you will, as you and I know it, is a gift to the entire world from the Hebrew people. That is a significant thing, because they're this generation forgotten largely in most of the world, and especially in our culture today. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. They still repeat that today. They still say that today. Clearly, most scholars say the Hebrew people here gave to the world their affirmation of faith, and in so doing, they indicated the foundation for life itself, especially for them, because this is what they believe. Ethically, that is important. Joshua 24 said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Same word, same Lord, same God. That's exactly what he's saying over again in a different way. The exclusiveness of that is indicated to us in this passage that we just read in Exodus chapter 20 is also important, because the prophets stress the ethical portion, the ethical elements of it, but God stressed the exclusive nature of himself to them. You see that in that passage. It describes him, we could say, as envious, because he envied the relationship that he had with them. But the better word is exactly the one that my translation used. That is the word jealous. We don't often ascribe that kind of characteristic to the God that we serve, but the scripture says that of him. We cannot get away from that. Jealous is the better word. Yahweh, if you will, as they knew him and deigned not to speak that name because they referenced him so, despised their practice of worshiping or following after, as the Old Testament says, other gods from time to time, and then coming back to them, back to him, particularly when they got into trouble. Now, it's important also to remember the Hebrew patriarchs, the oldest of the Hebrews that we know, came from a land known for polytheism, many gods. They were not that exclusive in that day. The later generations of the Hebrews, in fact, succumbed to this, partly because of their own doing oftentimes, but it was a constant struggle because of the pagan religions that were all around. You remember when they inhabited the land of promise, God told them to cross the river, enter the land, and get rid of the people that were there because of the nature of their worship. But they didn't do that, and oftentimes they succumbed to the temptation to be polytheistic or to chase after other gods, and that was a great problem for them. Now, this is not this is not meant to be an ancient history study, but we have to talk about that. We have to understand that a little bit because of that first commandment. That first commandment that we read there, verse 3, says, only God is God. Only God is God. You must not have any other God but me. Why? Because only God is God. Now, the scope of that is what I want you to try to see tonight for a minute. God requires that first place be given to him. But he also requires that no place at all be given to any other God. Do you see that in that passage? I want you to see it. I want you to go back and read it until you see that. Let me say it this way. Yahweh, God, in the face of all other gods are pretenders. Only God is God. And the significance of that is this. In God's eyes, Yahweh, God, is the only true God. All others are pretenders. And let me say it another way. All others are idols. All others are idols. The ancient Hebrews were threatened by this polytheistic culture that was all around them and by idolatry as well. Now, fast forward to today. May I say to you that nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. Only God is still God. And all others, pretenders, are idols. That's what we must come to understand. Because today, I fear that many Christians, many of us, many folk that you know, maybe perhaps many in the church, could be unwittingly having other gods before them. I think it's just true. So I want to suggest some things as we look at this problem for a few minutes and we think about this most significant passage here. Let me say to you first, the primary concept that I see in these passages that we read, the primary concept, identity, would be, this is kind of a review, so bear with me for a minute. We talked in a previous message, not too very long ago, I talked to you about theism. The affirmation of the reality of what we read in this passage. There is one and only one God. He is a personal God. He is a deity in the heavens somewhere. But some take that word, theism, belief in one God, and they put an A in front of it. And what does that yield? It yields the negative. It yields the negative. Rendering that negative there, the theist become a theist. There is no God. They have no belief in God or God. This is well known to you. You know exactly what I'm talking about, and we talked about that message. I said two things to you about that. I want to call to your attention one more time. There is what is known as theoretical atheism. Theoretical atheism. The theoretical atheist says, well, I base this on speculative reason, for lack of a better term. I have reasoned in my mind and come to the conclusion that there is no God. That's the theoretical atheist. This can be a very unusual thing. Because do you know that some theoretical atheists that you and I know follow the dictates of Jesus? They don't do it because they are the dictates of Jesus. What do we say about them? Well, they're good people, and they are. They are. Oftentimes, they are. They're very good folks. They do right things, good things for whatever the reason, but we say of them, knowing that they don't really have any belief, they don't espouse any belief in God, they may have said to you, well, I guess I'm what you'd call an atheist because I don't really believe in God. But we say about them, because they are our neighbor or whatever they might be, we say, well, they're good people. But they're not in most respects. You see, they many times, rather than being good people, they care only about themselves. They have a selfless basis for life. But the good thing about that is that there are not that many theoretical atheists. They're not that particularly overwhelming in our society. More common is what theologians call the practical atheist. We talked about that as well. These folks just live as if there is no God. They don't particularly espouse no belief, I don't believe in God. They just live that way all the time, every day. It's interesting that the Bible speaks about this individual. Mark this down. You can look it up later. Psalm 14:1 said, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. That's practical atheism and theoretical atheism summed up. The fool has reasoned his way to the fact, speculatively, that there is no God. How terribly tragic. But secondly, not only to identify some of these, let's think about idolatry for just a minute. Do you realize that in reading that text alone, there is ruled out the possibility of atheism? God says, I am. I exist. And you don't need to worship anybody but me. He rules out atheism at the get-go here, from the start here. But he points out the greater threat. Because he said in those verses I pointed out to you a minute ago, beyond verse 3, he said there is something else. There is that which is called idolatry, other gods. Not only am I the only one, but largely unnamed and unidentified are these known as other gods, and they can usurp the place of God in our hearts. That's the danger that we face if we don't understand this. You know, in biblical days, when these words were written and long before, it wasn't uncommon for someone to make a god. They'd take a piece of wood, they'd take a piece of a stone, or even a piece of metal such as it was in that particular day, and they would fashion something, they would form something, they would carve out, chisel out, or beat out of that piece of stone something, and they say, this is my God. And they would bow down and worship it. We all understand that. That was common in this particular day here. And the prophets warned against that over and over again. They railed against idolatry, making a god with your own hands and then bowing down and worshiping what you have made yourself. And they said, how absurd is this to do this? But if we look at Exodus chapter 20, verse 3 again, notice again, the indication here is not just merely that they were idol, idol, and then God, and then idol, idol, and then back to God. You see, God is saying to us, I think, something very significant and very important, even though that's exactly what they did. We can do the same thing. How is it, though we don't have a stone hammer and a chisel that we fashion, so though we don't have a cutting torch and a welding machine that we make something out of metal, though we don't form something with a chisel and a spoke shave out of wood, how significant is it, and how violative is it of this commandment in violation of it? How much are we when we have or hope to have wealth and we bow down to that? And we have public acclaim or materialistic idols of some sort. Even religion can become an idol, I would suggest to you. Look at some of the mega churches today and how some of them, even at this moment, have faltered and failed because of internal struggles there in which someone bowed down to the idol of religion. And many people have been hurt. Many things terribly gone wrong in some of these tremendously religious organizations here. But thirdly, look at the idea here. Not only the identity and the idolatry, but the idea, the danger. It seems a foolish idea, but it's a great problem when we give allegiance to another god. I think there's something that can happen here. I think when that occurs in our life, that a special form of blindness overtakes us. I think it can overwhelm us, and I want to suggest to you that we can become, because of our unawareness, if you will, and our idolatry, we become totally blinded to it, and we simply don't see it. We don't see it in this passage because God is so specific about it here. We simply overlook it and we miss it. So that's the primary concept, and I want you to grasp that. I hope that you can read further and grasp that. Secondly, notice the primary concept, but the powerful command. The powerful command. Read again verse 3. You must not have any other god but me. Literally, no other gods. Now, from the ethereal standpoint, from the spiritual or the heavenly standpoint, in this realm, there is no other. There is not one. This is affirmed here, but there is no other. That's the greatest reason, because this one is enough. He is enough. He is sufficient. He is the only one there. But secondly, existence. Existence. The reason for our existence is Him. He made us. He created us. If we forsake Him, haven't we forsaken our whole purpose for living and our purpose for being? I would suggest to you that we have. Our existence is because of Him, and it depends upon Him. And think thirdly then about eternity. In the balance would be eternity. As humans, God breathed into us the pneuma, the breath of life, and He created, the scripture says, a living soul which will live forever. So, in that sense, not fully realized on earth, but as we talked a little bit about heaven this morning, in that sense, our eternity is hanging in the balance because of our worship of another God who has no power, no nothing. And this one we have forsaken is the one who breathed literally life into us and gives to us the hope and the promise of eternity. Have we squandered our own eternity by substituting an idol? It destroys our hope. It robs us of eternal life. How foolish on our part. How literally absurd on our part to maybe squander eternal life. And finally, evil. Did you ever think that under other gods, evil flourishes? It does. It without question. Whatever hope of justice and right and other things on this earth, whatever hope we have of everything being made right at some point in the future, all depends on God, and it depends on our relationship to Him. Governing that relationship to otherwise evil is going to continue to flourish, and will just flourish from there on. So thirdly, the concept there and the command, the power of that command, then think of the personal challenge. Look at verse 3 one more time. I just cannot stress it enough there. I want you to know that when he says here, you must not have any other God but me, that holds legal authority. That is law. And it holds powerful legal authority. But let me also say to you that verse 3 is a personal challenge. It is primarily personal because it is given to us as individuals. Who else is going to do that? He's not talking to an entity other than someone personally. He's talking to you and to me. And the challenge requires one true God. What does he say? Give your life to him. Give your life to him. So here's the deep, thought-provoking question of the hour. What do you and I really believe? Do we believe in God, or do we believe about God? You see, that's what the real question comes down, because you and I know many people who profess an opinion. They say, I profess an opinion, I believe about God, and they may even give their allegiance, some allegiance in some form to him, but they serve an idol. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Some of you are thinking about someone who fits that category right now. Belief means what? It means faithing him. It means trusting him and giving our entire allegiance totally to him. That's what it means when it says you must not have any other God but me. Clearly. So I want to pose some questions in closing tonight, just for your thinking as you leave. I don't want to just chop this message off. I want you to think. Maybe you can jot them down. If you don't get them, we'll get them to you. Looking at your life, can you identify any other gods? To what do you give your allegiance? What takes, or what stands between me, you, and God? What takes priority over my worship and over my service? What gets the greatest consideration and time? Or maybe let me say it a simpler, shorter way. What's number one in my inner life? Just be honest. What is it? Jesus said, if any man would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. You know, I would admit to you that I had a wrong concept about that verse for a long time. When Jesus said, deny yourself, he's not talking about giving up something that I want. That's just the truth. But it's ceasing for me to occupy the throne and permitting God to have his rightful place on the throne of my heart. That's what he meant. So what is the one thing in your mind? If I say, what has your allegiance? What do you think of first? What is the greatest thing in your life? What pops in there first? What's number one? Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, other gods, will be added unto you. I want you to consider his claim. Just consider his claim on your life. Only one God, he's the one who created the universe. Would you give him up for another God? Some of us might have. He seeks our allegiance, and he wants to bless us to be the creatures that he created us to be. And the question is he God in your life, or do you serve another? You must not have any other God but me. Pray with me. Father, thank you tonight for the power of your word. Thank you for the way that it speaks to us, for the depth of it, the breadth of it. Help us to somehow see that and sense that. Help us to sense that those forces that are stirring all about us, that are calling out to us with the wealth of the world and the acclaim and all of the other things that so many seek, and in so doing, foolishly, how absurdly, we have created something to compete, we think, with the God of all creation, the God of the universe, the God who holds eternity for all of us in his hand. Help us that we might see in these commandments and in these tremendous passages, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Help us never to lose sight of that, and if we have, help us to come back to him in repentance and faith, and give to him our total faith, our total allegiance, our total belief, all that we have and are and ever hope to be, loving him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. I pray that these passages might have spoken to every one of us here tonight, and I pray that we'll leave this place more committed to serve you and no one else. Bless, we pray, and make us a blessing in the matchless name of Christ. And all his people said together in agreement, amen. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. God bless you. I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday evening, supper at 5:30, and our prayer service following that. Be safe going home tonight. God bless you.